Is this idling at 220 watts?
Yes.
Jeebus. Now, at the end of our PC Pro video, we told you guys that, yeah, it's awesome.
Woo, 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 woo.
But it lacks focus. Like, it's not really designed for a single task. It's a middle-of-the-road performer for everything. Not so with the creature that we are showing off today. This is the Comino RM, and it is designed for one thing and one thing only. Absolutely chewing through video rendering. It's got four RTX 2080 Ti's, a Threadripper CPU, and a design like nothing else I have ever seen before. Just like this segue, it's like nothing you've ever seen before. This video is brought to you by Glasswire. Instantly see your current and past network activity, detect malware, and block badly behaving apps with Glasswire. Check it out at the link in the video description to get 25% off. To be clear, I'm not saying this is a slow machine. When we put our $32,000 PC Pro up against a $33,000 Mac Pro, it was twice as fast in our Mark Bench benchmark, which is a project that we created identically in both Premiere Pro and Final Cut to see how fast a PC versus a Mac could encode a video. However, when we take a more specialized machine, can we beat the Mac Pro by more? There's only one way to find out. Here we go, time remaining. Oh wow, it's actually not ahead by that much, but it is ahead so far. Man, this new GPU encoding in Adobe Premiere really hits it, doesn't it? We're seeing GPU usage as high as 50, 70, I saw 80% for a second there, and that's all four of the RTX 2080 Ti's.
What's our power draw on that?
Oh, a cool 760 watts.
Really, that's all?
That's it?
Huh.
Yeah, it's efficient.
Not too bad.
I think a big part of it is just that it's running a Threadripper rather than an Epic, because instead of running at 3 gigahertz and change boost, this puppy is boosting to 4.25 gigahertz. It's a 32 core processor. It's nuts.
Oh, and it's done.
Oh, and it's done. Let's check the times. Encoding time, 1:45 for the Comino, 1:51 for the PC Pro. We've got a victory. Now it's still pretty expensive at around $15,000, but this kind of custom chassis work and the water cooling that's inside it does not come cheap, and it still costs about half as much as the PC Pro. Let's go on. Wow, okay. I was not expecting this. We only have one license for Solidworks Visualize, but apparently it's given us a little bit of leeway on that right now. So the purpose of this program is to take a project that you've created and render it in like a super cool photorealistic way for promotional imagery. So we're gonna go ahead and take this Camaro, which is included with the program, and we are going to output it as—
Yep, click right there. So that just brings up the thing. And make sure that the passes, yeah, make those each 1,000.
100,000 passes? Oh my lord. Enable denoiser? Ouch. You ready? Are we gonna blow a breaker, Alex?
I don't know, we might.
Are they hooked up to different breakers?
I'm not entirely sure.
Oh snap. Okay, well the CPUs are going, the GPUs haven't kicked in. We're at, holy, we're at 1,300 watts. How is it even doing that? It's not even hitting those GPUs, or so it thinks. It must be.
Yeah,
it Task
is.
Manager has to be confused. Whoa! Hey, I mean, why buy a space heater for your bedroom for the winter? Just pick up one of these puppies. Holy crap! This is only halfway through its passes and this one is done. It goes to show you that if your workload just relies on raw GPU muscle, a Quadro is not gonna do anything for you that a GeForce can't. To put this in perspective, we are twice the performance of our PC Pro, which was 36 times the speed of the Mac Pro. And we're half the price. While we wait around for the PC Pro to finish, let's set it to 100,000 passes. Let's start up the render again and have a look at the incredible cooling system in the Comino RM here. When I filmed my initial unboxing of this thing on our Short Circuit channel, go subscribe by the way, all I could really say was, What am I even looking at here? Because you got your CPU with this crazy custom block they've designed on it. You've got a loop whose order kind of makes no sense. Like it splits out and then half of the water goes to the CPU and the other half goes to the four GPUs, which are all in like these little like GPU sandwiches under the motherboard. And then you've got these incredible shielded PCI Express risers that actually run around to the underside of the motherboard tray, leaving the top of the system looking really clean. Well, as it turns out, we've been in touch with them and they've explained every funny thing that we noticed about the design. And it was all with the intention of creating a rendering and AI just brute of a machine that is still standalone, so it doesn't require like a chilled air cooling system in a data center or anything like that, and reasonably quiet. So, the reason that they went with these 140 millimeter Noctua PPC 3000 RPM fans is that they've got a great combination of both airflow moving capacity and static pressure. So they've got this seal here on the back so that the triple 120 millimeter radiator is able to get all of the air moving through it instead of spilling out around it. The reasoning behind the triple SFX 750 watt power supplies basically came down to avoiding ATX power supplies because they would have interfered with them being able to fit the triple radiator, and also avoiding noisy, redundant server style power supplies, which are, well, noisy.
Whoa, hey, okay.
Ah. Now we ran this benchmark in a room temperature room, so about 22 degrees Celsius, 23 degrees Celsius, for an hour and a half to give the system all the time it needed to reach equilibrium. And they managed 77 degrees at the highest for our CPU and a maximum of just 66 degrees for our hottest GPU. So as crazy as it sounds initially, to split up your coolant flow half to the CPU and half to four GPUs, looks like that was the right move. The benefits of a water cooling system like this are twofold. One is that each of these four GPUs, it's crazy, it only looks like two GPUs, doesn't it? Because they're like, they're sandwiched together. Each of them was turboing to 1800 megahertz during that long intensive test. And according to Comino anyway, they can be quickly and easily swapped out for maintenance without even draining the water cooling loop, which I'm kind of looking at going, really? Because what am I even looking at here?
The GPUs are all kind of on a tray that comes out.
Oh, there's a security torx there. Okay, well, I'm a little worried that, whoa, that's gonna happen. Come on, baby. Come on, you can do it. Don't be shy. Oh, there we go. What's it stuck on, you know? Maybe you just need to just force it. Okay, I see their point, but I'm also not 100% sure that I agree with it. Yes, you could strip the cooler off of another 2080 Ti, take that bare PCB, slop it on there, and in practice, I think that opportunities to change out graphics cards without draining the loop would be few and far between because, you know, if you wanted to upgrade, for example, you would obviously need to replace the block. Should we pull a card off and just have a look at the block? I'm
sure,
curious.
Sure, yeah, do it.
Right now, it's held on by only thermal compound, which seems fine. Should be fine, Alex. Just chill. Oh, interesting. That is a very unusual approach. Normally, manufacturers don't try to get the tolerances so tight on their copper blocks. And they use a pad for memory instead of thermal compound. And actually, you can see the wisdom of that. So there's some learnings in here for Comino. You can see that the contact between these memory chips and the block is not actually amazing. One of the reasons for that is that when you're mounting surface mount BGA components like these GPUs, the tolerances can be a little bit off, and it's far more important you have good contact on the GPU because these memory chips don't actually output that much heat. You can see their GPU contact is excellent, so what they'd probably be better off with in a future revision of this block is bringing this part down just a fraction of a millimeter and then using pads for these, just like they do with the voltage regulators and MOSFETs and all that kind of stuff. We can take a moment now to appreciate Comino's PCI Express daughter board riser card thing. So what's really neat about these is they allow them with just these skinny rounded connectors. So instead of the like big flat PCI Express extenders, to take a full 16x slot worth of bandwidth around the motherboard, around to the back of the motherboard tray. These right here each handle 8x worth of bandwidth. So if you hook up just one of them, you would have an 8x slot. And if you hook up the second one, you've got the full 16x bandwidth to your card, which might not be that important for gaming, but for compute applications, which is exactly what they're doing here, that's absolutely critical. You want as much bandwidth to the slot as you can get. I figured it out, Alex. There's angled screws down here.
Angled screws?
What? Angled, they're hiding.
Oh, lordy.
Ugh. Whoa, hey, hi, ho, hey, how's it going? That is how the power supplies come out. While I'm not sure I quite buy it on the graphics cards, power supply swaps do appear to be pretty much as simple as pippity poppity modular interface, screw in a new one, and you're ready to rock. We are back up and running, so we're gonna do our last benchmark against our $32,000 PC. This is Octane Bench. This is a GPU rendering benchmark. Let's go ahead and have a look at our usage here. Okay, they're both fast. So that's nice. And a big surprise to absolutely no one, the Comino RM crushinated the PC Pro. With that said, as we said about the PC Pro in our original video, it's an all-rounder. So if we were to run into a situation where we were working on a project or a data set that was so big that we need more than 11 gigabytes of video memory, the PC Pro would absolutely pull out ahead. So this is more of a lesson in buying the right tool for the job than it is necessarily just a sales pitch for the Comino RM. It's a super cool machine, but unless you absolutely know you need one of these, I probably wouldn't call them up and send them a purchase order. That said, I would love to use this as our video rendering server. It's freaking fast. Just like the speed at which I'm gonna transition to our sponsor. Blinkist takes the best insights and most important information from thousands of nonfiction books and condenses them into 15 minutes. You can either read or listen from the app, and you can learn about self-development and success, business and finance, parenting, psychology, self-help, all kinds of amazing topics. And it'll help you discover different perspectives and views to incorporate into your everyday life. You would be amazed how much you can learn in 15 minutes. They've got offline downloads, which makes it perfect for commutes, and some of their most popular titles include What to Do When Machines Do Everything, which explains how automation can be incorporated into current business models, and Streaming, Sharing, Stealing, which outlines successful companies like Apple, Netflix, and Amazon on how they use data to understand their consumers in the ever-changing entertainment industry. It's available on the Google Play Store and Apple's App Store, and the first 100 people to go to Blinkist.com/LinusTechTips, we're gonna have the link below, are gonna get unlimited access for 1 week to try it out. Also, they have full-length audiobooks now, with premium subscribers getting special pricing up to 65% off retail price. So go check them out down below. If you guys enjoyed this video, maybe check out the short circuit where we did our initial unboxing and impressions of it. Actually, we kind of covered everything that we said in that one, but in more depth today. So maybe go check out the PC Pro, where we built the 32-core Quadro RTX 8000 monster that you see before you. Case alone is like over $1,000. So ridiculous. And look, it doesn't even have as much front I/O as this one.